Hi, my name is Dr. Nisha Viswanathan, and I'm an assistant professor of medicine and director of the long COVID program at UCLA. Like many of you, I first started noticing patients by late 2020 and onwards who previously had a COVID infection and developed persistent symptoms. It drove me to start the program to create a knowledge base around this topic to better assist our primary care doctors and patients.
I have no disclosures.
The goal of today's presentation is to help empower you, the primary care physician, to feel more comfortable with starting a workup for and providing management of the symptoms of long COVID. The prior presentation helped you identify which symptoms to look for, and today we will build on that knowledge base. Once you've identified a patient who may be struggling with long COVID, it is important to set aside a specific appointment just to perform a thorough history and physical. Even if you know a patient well, repeating the medical history may reveal new diagnoses you were not previously aware of. For example, something they were told by a prior PCP that they had previously failed to inform you of. During this history, obtain a separate COVID-related history, including their symptoms while they were infected, if they were hospitalized, and what that hospital course looked like. In addition, doing a thorough social history will be key for treatment later. In my experience, many patients started drinking more alcohol during the pandemic, but their dietary habits may have changed as well. Next, a comprehensive review of symptoms is important, and the timeline surrounding these symptoms is equally as important. If a patient was having some of these symptoms and they've worsened after having COVID, that would be a different management plan than if some of these were a new symptom. Providers can also ask patients to complete a list of these prior to the appointment to be time conscious. If you plan to ask these during clinic, I recommend providers state something like, "In the effort of time, I'll read through a list of symptoms. Please respond yes or no, and then we can take a deeper dive where necessary." This will also avoid speaking about other symptoms that may not be consistent with long COVID. Now we get to the meat of why we all came here. The first symptom we will discuss today is shortness of breath, which can be vague and may be confused with fatigue by some patients. Watching a patient walk and actually being present for a part of their 6-minute walk test may give you a good idea of their exercise tolerance as well. If the 6-minute walk test is not a part of your normal clinic workflow, ensuring that your staff is comfortable with this and knowing when to alert you is important. For example, if a patient's oxygen is less than 88%, or their oxygen saturation drops by more than 5%. It's important to always remember that shortness of breath could also be an indicator of cardiac issues. Pulmonary function tests can be helpful to delineate new onset or worsening asthma or a new diagnosis of pulmonary fibrosis, which is something you should always keep in mind, especially if a patient was ventilated during their COVID course. Imaging studies can also be helpful for diagnosis and evaluation, but not always necessary. If your PFTs show signs of restrictive airway disease, you should consider albuterol or steroid-based inhalers. Unfortunately, the data is not strong for using these in patients without significant findings on their PFTs. But in my clinical experience, I will provide those medications and monitor for improvement. If the patients endorse no improvement at follow-up, then I will consider discontinuing the medications to avoid polypharmacy. Another option is pulmonary rehab, which has been very effective for many of my patients in breath retraining. Of note, pulmonary rehab may not be tolerated by all your patients, as there is an exercise component which may flare their fatigue. Biofeedback therapy is another option, but may not be available in every community. Qigong belly breathing has been validated for use in COVID to help with shortness of breath. Instruct your patients to place their hands over their chest and abdomen and then take a deep, mindful breath that leads to expansion across the chest, ribs, lungs, and diaphragm. Then ask your patients to exhale completely and relax their chest, ribs, lungs, and diaphragm. Other options include yawn to a smile, which involves starting with a yawn, spreading your arms out, and then bringing your arms in and smiling. Another easier option is humming while exhaling. Asking patients to do these at least 10 times per exercise and a few times per day can be helpful. If patients want breath retraining therapy at home, they should consider stasis.org. This is a paid program which bills itself as a guided breath retraining program for those struggling with long COVID. Cardiac symptoms are common in long COVID, with patients complaining of palpitations or chest pain, but could include shortness of breath. Consider a basic workup of labs, EKG, and imaging. Echoes can be helpful in elucidating possible myocarditis or signs of ischemia. If your workup is negative, consider doing a cardiopulmonary exercise test to help elucidate if the source of their persistent fatigue is cardiac or pulmonary in nature. The American College of Cardiology came out with guidelines this year to help guide our management of COVID-related heart conditions. It helps providers delineate the source of their patient's symptoms, whether they be due to myocarditis or PASC. In addition, they provide return-to-play guidelines for our more active patients, including athletes. We should briefly discuss post-vaccination myocarditis at this time, because it could be a source of your patient's symptoms. This is where the history of their symptoms is very important, as many times patients will endure symptoms that came after their vaccine as opposed to their COVID infection. The risk of myocarditis is small, and to minimize the risk of developing myocarditis amongst young men, the CDC modified their guidelines this year to recommend spacing the first and second dose of mRNA vaccines. Also, most patients who develop myocarditis do note resolution of symptoms within a few months, so this is unlikely to be a long-term complication or a reason to avoid vaccination. If your patient does have myocarditis, involving a cardiologist early is important to help with guideline-directed therapy. Furthermore, you should counsel your patients to avoid exercise for the following 3 to 6 months based on their symptoms, and consider cardiac rehab when available once their symptoms resolve. Many of you have heard of dysautonomia syndrome, such as POTS or orthostatic hypotension, which could be the source of your patient's symptoms. In my experience, many of my patients have done research on the internet and have come in asking to be screened for these conditions. This is in large part because dysautonomia can lead to a panoply of symptoms and can help explain their medical condition. In the clinic, the quickest way to evaluate would be to do a 6-minute walk test and extended orthostatics. Autonomic reflex screens, or ARS, are more specific but can be difficult to obtain or lead to prolonged wait times, which could delay diagnosis. Therefore, history can be a very important part of helping you consider this diagnosis. Once you've established there is likely dysautonomia, treatment comes as a combination of options rather than one fixed option. In the short term, consider options like compression stockings or abdominal binders or keeping legs elevated. Patients can also increase salt and water intake. Medications can be helpful, but consider adverse effects, as some of these can worsen orthostatic hypotension and not be well tolerated, especially by our older patients. Long-term graded exercise has had the greatest effect in this patient population. The Levine protocol has been validated in treatment. Patients start with a recumbent or seated exercise, either on the mat or a rower, and build time spent on exercising over a 3-month period of time. Providers can print and provide this protocol to local physical therapists to assist patients, as self-delivery has not been particularly successful in my experience. The ACC came out with specific guidelines for athletes, which I have used to help my more active patients as well. The main takeaways are that asymptomatic individuals do not need to decrease their exercise, and patients with symptoms warrant extra workup and exercise abstinence. Fatigue is unfortunately much harder to manage and treat. Therefore, these patients often need more frequent clinical check-ins to track symptoms over time. Your workup should be much broader, and your differential should include anemia, undiagnosed kidney or liver failure, infectious diseases, vitamin deficiencies, thyroid diseases, obstructive sleep apnea, fibromyalgia, undiagnosed mental health conditions, and autoimmune conditions. Undiagnosed sleep conditions, including obstructive sleep apnea, but also type 2 narcolepsy, is very common in this population, so I cannot stress the importance of a stop, bang, or sleep study. Based on your workup, you can determine your next steps. Often your initial workup will be negative, and patients will return to your office seeking relief. Alternative medicine has proven quite helpful in treatment. For many allopathic providers, including myself, we're not as comfortable with non-FDA-regulated medications or therapies, such as acupuncture or cupping, for our patients. Yet, if we don't offer these to our patients, they will often seek these treatments with non-physician providers anyway. When counseling your patients, diet is a very important part of the discussion. The low-histamine, anti-inflammatory diet, which is primarily a Mediterranean diet that minimizes meat and dairy consumption, has anecdotally had a big impact on fatigue. I've had a few patients that cut out all sugar from their diet, and their fatigue has completely resolved. One patient recently called me when she had had birthday cake to have the fatigue return. Mental health conditions are also very common. COVID can cause hormonal imbalances in the brain, leading to new-onset depression and anxiety in patients who may never have struggled previously. Sertraline is more activating, which can help with the fatigue, and duloxetine is more effective when patients are having signs or symptoms of fibromyalgia. As for the activating medications, Adderall should be considered sparingly or not at all. In my experience, these medications can do the opposite and worsen fatigue. Non-amphetamine-based modafinil can be difficult to obtain for your patients, but if you code this with type 2 narcolepsy, you can get this covered for your patients. Sleep quality is also important, which is why doing the Pittsburgh Sleep Quality Inventory, PSQI, for your patients can provide you more information about their insomnia. Try to avoid Ambien or Sonata, as these may not improve your patient's sleep quality and could worsen fatigue. Often the fatigue in long COVID is compared to the fatigue experienced by patients struggling with myalgic encephalitis or chronic fatigue syndrome, also known as ME-CFS. We do not have evidence yet to support that these two conditions are related, but much of your treatment guidance stems from the work done on this field. The last major system affected by long COVID is the neurological system, which comes as a combination of symptoms that can vary from conditions that affect the brain, such as cognitive impairment and brain fog, to peripheral neuropathies and dysautonomia. The workup for a patient's neurological symptoms is diverse due to a wide differential. This includes diabetes, thyroid disease, kidney and liver disease, autoimmune conditions, vitamin B12 deficiency, infectious diseases, sensory neuropathies, and myopathies. Small fiber neuropathy deserves its own special note, as it is an extremely common symptom of long COVID. Patients will often complain about zaps or bites, as well as a combination of other symptoms, such as pain, sweating, and GI symptoms. Studies show it may be an early sign of long COVID. Treatment options are similar to those used for neuropathic pain. These include oral medications and creams, with the goal of avoiding opiates if possible. Aquatic physical therapy in a hot pool can help with muscle and joint pains while building strength. Massage and acupuncture can also be effective for pain relief. Brain fog is another frequent issue in long COVID. Cognitive assessments such as MoCA or mini mental status exam were created to evaluate dementia and are frequently not useful in the management of long COVID in my experience. Brain fog has been tough to manage and often can correlate with fatigue. It's important to treat other underlying conditions such as OSA or depression, which could worsen brain fog. Cognitive rehabilitation, when available, through speech therapy can be helpful. But if this isn't an option, the Luminosity app is a paid app that provides games and challenges to patients to help with improving their mental acumen. Advice caution, though, as doing too much of these can also increase a brain strain and worsen brain fog. As a PCP, you can provide patients in clinic with tips on pacing themselves, taking breaks, keeping a to-do list, keeping a planner, and writing notes themselves that can help in management. Consider supplements as well. Loss of taste and smell are seen most frequently with prior waves of COVID and not as frequently in the Omicron variant. Unfortunately, there are still some patients who have not had this sense return after 2+ years. Subspecialist involvement like ENT has been minimally helpful, but focusing on smell retraining can be more helpful. Patients should pick 4 bright essential oils, for example, rose, lemongrass, mint, and do a mindful smelling multiple times per day. This should focus on patients trying to remember the scent, try to recall any emotions that are associated with it to help connect the smell to their memories. Absent.org is a website that provides support groups and forums for patients to discuss their struggles and other strategies. Patients can also look into the apps Nosewell and Sniff. There isn't much role for medications, although a few supplements may prove helpful. If patients have associated sinus congestion, it is recommended to manage similarly to allergic rhinitis. I do feel it is important to stress the importance of screening for depression and anxiety in this population. You can provide your patients some of these assessments prior to their visit to help guide your treatment plan. Medications and therapy are the crux of treatment, regardless of if the cause of their depression and anxiety is due to long COVID or not. If patients are not open to individual therapy, or even for those that are, group therapy and support groups can also be offered. A paper in Nature magazine from March 2022 found that long COVID could be prevented about 15% of the time with vaccination, and that this was most commonly preventable with mRNA vaccines. Furthermore, there is a small amount of evidence whereby patients with long COVID are finding some symptom relief from vaccination after their diagnosis. It is not clear the mechanism of action for this. For many patients with long COVID, this is oftentimes the first experience with chronic illness. As a primary care provider, our patients often come to us to discuss how to manage work or home life while dealing with their symptoms, treatments, and frequent doctor's visits. Most primary care doctors are comfortable with FMLA leave policies. COVID's acute symptoms, interestingly, can last up to 12 weeks. Therefore, it is appropriate to provide leave for this time with specific checkpoints to follow up on their symptoms. Documentation of initial symptoms can prove helpful, especially in helping you if a patient seems to be transitioning to long COVID. Long COVID is a disability. It leads to impairment in both physical and mental states. Therefore, it is a protected condition under the American Disabilities Act. Utilizing assessments to evaluate symptoms can help you determine if patients can or cannot work. It is reasonable in the early stages of your workup to provide time off for your patients to have testing and appointments performed for timely diagnosis of other conditions. If their symptoms persist, considering further disability is at your discretion. Long COVID is not always a cause for disability. For example, if a patient has impaired smell and taste only, it may not necessarily impact their livelihood if they are a secretary, but may be a cause for disability if they are a chef. Therefore, it is important to understand your patient's job and what the schedule adjustments can be offered to them. In my experience, patients who are able to work, even if only a few hours per week, tend to have more purpose, which can help stave off mental health issues. If there is one point I hope you take away from this presentation, it is that long COVID is a real medical condition, and patients should be treated with empathy while trying to obtain and understand their history. Other important points include monitoring their symptoms over time to help guide therapy, considering the use of alternative therapies early in management, and emphasizing vaccinations where possible. It's been a wonderful time speaking with you, and I hope you now feel more confident in long COVID management and treatment.